in your perspective, how important is design thinking in our life? Because we say design thinking, it's important to solve the challenges through creativity.
You know, it's funny. I always think in the sense of history and in the context of history. And it's funny how I was making the point earlier about how we often think that the past or people in the past, it's all derived on the basis of records and what's written, etc. But it's art and architecture from the past that also teaches us a lot. It tells us what they were thinking, what they wanted to be seen as, how they dressed, what they ate. All of this is communicated through art. Records give you one part of the puzzle. It's the art and the design and the aesthetic in how they saw their buildings and how they designed their living spaces and how they designed their monumental spaces. All of that gives you a more complete picture of what the past was. And frankly, that's what we should also aim for. If we are here on the earth for a certain period of time, we might as well spend our time with a certain aesthetic quality about the way we do it, rather than leave behind only plastic and garbage for the coming generations.
Why still in 21st century there is a gender bias happening in the workplace?
People, we always talk about the caste system, right? But the biggest caste system of all is between man and woman. It's always been the case. And I, in fact, in my third book, I talk about a lot of women thinkers, a lot of women public figures from Indian history, because I think in the 21st century it's fascinating that we're in 2019, but every time we talk about Indian history it's about kings and empires. Where are the women? And it's not just women in the workplace. I work with history. Where are the women in history? They're there. We just need to go out and find them. Just as now the women are here in the workplace, we just have to make space for them in that workplace. And I think, you know, increasingly as time passes, the newer generations that are coming in are much more educated, they're much more attuned, and they understand the importance of a fairer society. You know, it's also partly about how we educate our girls, right? Often, now of course it's changing, but I remember in my childhood, you know, girls were always taught to not only say study, but also think actively as girls. When you're a boy, you're never taught think like a boy. You can be what you are. With girls, there's always this constant thinking at the back, this voice at the back of your head saying, oh, I'm a girl, can I do this? Oh, I'm a girl, can I do that? It is a form of social engineering. It's an engineering of the mind. That we need to change, and that is a long-term process happening that will happen through education and greater reading, greater awareness and greater exposure to the rest of the world and again to the past, because as I said, we do have female icons in the past as well who broke through male bastions, who stood up and said things that were inconvenient in their own day and time. And I think the more we highlight that aspect, the more women also realize that, hold on, you know, why should we hold back in that sense? Any place you go, no matter how advanced they are, or how advanced they claim to be, there still remains a certain gap as far as gender is concerned. Gender remains the elephant in the room which has not been addressed fully. I think women now need to walk in and claim that space for themselves. And that confidence, I think, will, you know, make sure that they can then hold on to that space and increase the space and continue to inspire other women as well, and boys. I don't see why women must only inspire women. There's plenty to learn from women for men as well. In fact, you know, toxic masculinity more than a crisis with femininity is something we need to address.